My name's Ozzy Osbourne. I'd like to say hi.
All aboard!
After leaving Black Sabbath, I was in those guys for 12 years, I believe. And it was a challenge that I had to get on with, and I think I'm doing such a bad job.
After over a decade with Black Sabbath, John Michael Osborne said goodbye to the doomy godfathers of heavy, heavy metal and struck out on his own. 5 hit albums and dozens of mega tours later, Ozzy hasn't looked back.
It's an achievement. I never won a medal. I never did anything in my life before, but it's like making a platinum record is always the biggest thrill, you know. I'm crazy, but I'm fun crazy. I do things for fun. I'm a practical joker, actually. I'm a prankster. The thing with that bat, when I bit the head off that bat and so, which I didn't know was a bat at the time. I thought it was one of those rubber toy things. But as soon as I crunched the head, I then realized, oh my God, what have I done, you know? My stage presence, which I always vowed I would never do, take the Ozzy off stage and bring him at home. And it was happening before my eyes without me even realizing it. So I checked myself in, and it was very, when I first went in there, I was scared stiff. I thought, my God, what have I taught myself into now? People think that I'm just, you know, like a madman. I'm not a madman. I'm a very determined man. I have a lot of beliefs that are strong. I have a lot of disbeliefs that are also strong, but I'm still Ozzy, and I still love everyone.
Outrageous filth, and we've got to do something about it.
Pyromania, no question. Burn a building. Burn, burn, burn.
In 1985, heavy metal music came under fire. Rock and roll, especially hard rock and roll, was due for its biggest public trial since the 1950s, when the Parent Music Resource Center conducted congressional hearings to discuss the imagery, lyrics, and moral suggestions of heavy metal music. No band was safe, as the loudest kind of rock was attacked from every conceivable angle.
Twisted Sister, the hit song from the album, We're Not Gonna Take It, was released as a video, which you saw just a moment ago, a video in which the band members proceed to beat up Daddy, who won't let them rock.
The reason people pick on the heavy metal music and its fans so much is because the adults in this world are actually jealous of the freedom we have. They kind of look at the young kids who just like have not a care in the world, like, yeah, party! And they're kind of like angry that they no longer have this freedom.
This is Motley Crue. Their albums for Electra Asylum sell millions, and they're one of the top 10 grossing concert bands this year. Their albums include songs like Livewire, quote, I'll either break her face or take down her legs. Get my ways, it will. Go for the throat, never let loose. Going in for the kill.
They say, oh, they're bad, they're evil. But we're not bad, we're not evil. We're just creating great music, and we're having a really good time. But obviously, it's just like with Elvis Presley. I mean, look, they went and photographed him from the crotch down, right?
The outrageous edge of rock and roll has shifted its focus from Elvis's pelvis to the saw protruding from Blackie Lawless's codpiece on a Wasp album.
I got this glint in my eye whenever I'm performing, which keeps people off balance where they're asking, is he or isn't he serious about this? Those people have obviously never seen that glint. I mean, how can any grown man walk around with a 12-inch saw blade between his legs and take that seriously?
As a result of the hearings, the PMRC and the record industry agreed on a policy of voluntary warning labels. While congressmen's wives were bad rap and heavy metal, the artists themselves were performing some good deeds. The Hearing Aid Project brought over 40 hard rock musicians together to sing an all-star song and contribute to a compilation album. The proceeds went to fight world hunger. Ronnie James Dio, the man behind the Hearing Aid Project, says good deeds aren't necessarily going to erase heavy metal's bad rap.
I just don't see it changing anything at all. Preconceived notions are very difficult to change. And aside from that, we didn't do it for that reason. So maybe I can so unequivocally say that it's not going to happen because it doesn't matter.
You don't like the stuff? Don't listen to it. Simple as that.
The British Empire has stood for over 1,000 years, an ageless culture defined by a quiet devotion to God, Queen, and country. But in the last decade, a new tradition has threatened all the gains the British have made since the Norman conquest. Let's not forget that the land that gave us Shakespeare, Dickens, and Churchill also gave us Zeppelin, Sabbath, and Purple. Today, the leading purveyors of the loudest English tradition are undoubtedly Iron Maiden and Judas Priest. It's a long way from the sweaty pubs of Birmingham to the sweaty stage of Madison Square Garden. For Judas Priest, it's a climb that started way back in 1969. 10 hit albums later, the Turbo Lovers are bigger and badder than ever.
The great thing about this band is that we consistently enjoy a continuing success and a growth. There's still the excitement and the energy and the enthusiasm still is being put out by this band all these years later.
I think that every artist in show business for as long as it has existed has had to have some sort of image. It's an important fact, you can't deny it, you know, you do have to have that.
We simply love what we do. We have an absolutely incredible time. The ability to write good heavy metal songs is still within the band. All of those ingredients together have kept Judas Priest where we are today.
The guitars are just like completely awesome. It's not even jazz, it's beyond jazz, cosmic jazz maybe. Singing's pretty good, you know, I mean, he's an ugly guy, but he's, you know, singing's pretty good.
Like Judas Priest, Iron Maiden played every pit in England to earn their success. In 1985, they finally reached the American top 20 with a 2-record concert album, Live After Death.
We can do outrageous things musically and still keep the fire and the Maiden sound without changing anything or altering anything in terms of the chemistry.
This year, Iron Maiden celebrate their 10th anniversary with their most successful album to date, Somewhere in Time, and a single you can actually sing along to, Wasted Years.
It was originally going to be called Golden Years, and we changed it because of the David Bowie connotation, and also it sounded like an invitation to a wedding anniversary. So that Golden Years is really the message. It's like, you know, don't waste your time. Get stuck in and, you know, enjoy life, be productive, live it to the full.
The youth of America wants to thrash right now.
In the last couple of years, kids all over the world decided heavy metal needed a kick in the butt. Whether you call it speed metal, thrash metal, death metal, or hardcore metal, it's almost always faster, louder, and usually younger than the metal you can hear on the radio or get from the major record companies. Today, speed metal has become a massively popular underground movement that's about to take the mainstream metal world by storm.
A lot heavier and faster, less melodic.
A lot less melodic.
I think that's what people want to hear. All those Iron Maiden fans, they really want to hear us.
With a lot more aggression,
yeah.
And a lot more fun involved too, I think. We don't take everything so serious like, yeah, a lot of bands do.
Welcome to our nightmare. It just can't walk away. Stop you.
We kind of deal more with reality instead of make-believe. You know, we don't sing about Dungeons and Dragons and little fairies and stuff like that.
We do what we do, and we like it, we stick it out.
Mm.
And if you don't like it, we put another one out.
And
if you don't like that, we put another one out. You like it in the end, just to get us off your back, right?
But you do like it, or at least you're beginning to. This year, Metallica reached the top 30 with their album Master of Puppets, and Anthrax, Slayer, and Megadeth each released records on a major label for the first time.
We're sort of like one step, we're like furthest out in like left field, pretty much from the middle of any of the sort of bigger heavy metal bands today. you know, sort of as unsafe as you can get. And we get away with it.
This is the next thing, I think, for the next 10 years or so.
Maybe it'll be around for the next 10 years, but even the biggest fans will admit the volume, savage imagery, and raw energy of speed metal isn't for everyone.
They got to start getting used to it.
They got
to
feel the aggression.
Yeah,
of it.
It's different from mainstream.
You got to feel it.
Music's got to grow.
Because if you're like living a nice lifestyle and you have no problems, you put on a record, you know, our record, and you won't get it. You got to have some problems.
People over here find that difficult to deal with because it's kind of extreme, you know. But we do it anyhow, and it's popular anyhow. All the people who are bitching about it are people who never heard it.
We're going to do basically what we set out to do, and that's break all the rules and have as much fun while we're doing it as we can.
More than any other town in America, Los Angeles is the city you think of when you think of heavy metal. Van Halen, Motley Crue, Rat, Quiet Riot, are all part of a long legacy of loud music born and bred in the City of Angels. And it all starts on the Sunset Strip.
There's so much room for everybody to be playing in Hollywood, because there's so many places to play, you know, like we showed you, the Roxy, the Troubadour, the Whiskey, you know, all of the above.
Plus a lot of the contacts for the whole industry are right here. That's like one of the best things about Los Angeles.
We used to play a number of different people's songs in the bars that we used to play. You know, 5-hour sets, you sit there and you walk into a bathroom which just basically has a pipe that goes down to the ground, and as soon as the ground can't absorb anymore, you're standing in what's normally known as
These guys make sure things happen in Hollywood. If it wasn't for these guys, it would be much weirder than it is already.
Whatever sells, LA tries to do, so that's how all the bands around here try to act. Whatever's selling, then you find like 20 new bands that do it.
It's so trendy to go in the stupid little clubs around here, and all these people are handing you free tickets with haircut discounts on the back of it. Who needs that stuff?
LA's trendy, it inspires whatever's cool at that time.
So LA is trendy. So what? The city continues to produce more bands per square foot than any other place in the world. Some of them are going to be good, some of them won't. But boys with guitars will always be drawn to L.A. like bugs to a light bulb.
It's sort of like rock and roll is a gamble, and Los Angeles is like the perfect, it's like the big slot machine that you go to play. Because if you gamble it all here, if you gamble it all in Los Angeles, you know, you're either going to fall the hardest or you're going to cash in the biggest.
The rudest, crudest, and usually the nudest rock and roll band.
What more could we possibly add? 3 hit albums, plenty of headlines, and endless stories about life in the raunchiest of rock and roll bands have made the words Motley Crue synonymous with, well, Motley Crue. Bassist Nikki Sixx founded the band, and he still calls most of the shots. But he let us know that there's room for everybody to join in the fun.
When the band started in 1980 and 81, I wrote mostly all the music, and now it's like gotten to the point where we really all contribute because we're all four together all the time. It comes across in the music.
Over the last couple of years, the crew haven't just been making records. They've been making headlines. In late 1984, vocalist Vince Neil was at the wheel of a car that crashed, killing Hanoi Rocks drummer Razzle. Vince was convicted of manslaughter and driving while intoxicated. This past summer, he spent 30 days behind bars. This spring, drummer Tommy Lee made happier headlines when he married actress Heather Locklear. Nikki Sixx figures any band that makes the news probably makes the charts, too.
We are a rock and roll band. You know, it's not classical music. It's not pop music. It's not bubblegum music. We are a rock and roll band. And we do get in trouble, you know, now and then. Everyone's gotten in trouble. But the bottom line is we want to have a whole lot of fun.
With Home Sweet Home and stuff like that, I think, you know, we just did that to just say we've done that. Now we're going to go back and just beat on the serious rock for a while.
Yeah, there's a lot of different types of music on the Theater Pain album. I mean, there's like blues, there's the slow songs, and there's kind of stuff. We're just kind of getting back into the more guitar-oriented stuff. Like the first album, Rawr.
Yeah, much rawer.
More street.
Right now, the crew are in Los Angeles working on their fourth album. We'll get to hear it early next year. But until then, we can tell you the title. All you have to do is think of three words very close to Crew's heart. Girls, girls, girls.
We got girls, girls, girls from, you know, from strip clubs, because we hit most of strip clubs around the country. So, you know, I went ahead and put the tattoo on my arm, so now, because I really like the name, so I figured if I put the tattoo on, there's no way they could...
They could change the title.
So now we're kind of stuck with it. Our main objective is to get bigger and badder and ruder and sleazier than anybody else that even stepped on a stage or even thought of being on a stage.
What do you think of when you think of heavy metal? Guitars, girls in spandex, boys in denim, big amps, big drums, big arenas, big hits. Well, we're forgetting about two simple things. Where would heavy metal be without big hair and makeup?
Flexnet, yes. The motley hat mold, as we call it.
My favorite thing about makeup, people walk up to me and say, you look better without it. I say, I hope so.
A person's look never changes how they sound. So, but if you feel a certain way, then you sort of exemplify that in the way you dress.
From Kiss to Bon Jovi, from Alice Cooper to Motley Crue, what you put on your face can be as important as what you put on your vinyl.
The way we look, the way we dress, and our sound is all an icing on the attitude. It all stems from the same thing, so it's all relative in the first place.
We've always tended towards more the glam than the heavy metal, than because to us, heavy metal leaned more on the punk side.
I think a look of a band is important to any band, you know, I mean, again, going back to the idea of, say, our first album where you got something like just Bon Jovi, and the way I played down the looks of the band because I didn't want to be pegged as a pretty boy band.
A lot of people are saying, well, this is a glam band, and we're a glamorous rock and roll band is what we are. We like to dress up and for the audience. That's what you fell for,
the but sometimes your rouge might rub somebody the wrong way.
I got arrested once with a full face of makeup on. In the middle of the night in some hick town in upstate New York, and I spent the night in jail with a full face of makeup. And I think you can imagine, the cops had a field day. Let's face it, folks, I was in a lot of trouble.
When you think of heavy metal, you think of the electric guitar. Whether it's producing spiny leads, raging rhythm parts, or subtle harmonics, the guitar is always at center stage in the musical drama that is heavy metal. Seattle's Jimi Hendrix was probably the first guitar hero. The first guy who could really blow people away with what he could do with the instrument. On the other side of the Atlantic, mild-mannered Jimmy Page blew up the blues and created the prototype for two decades of heavy metal with his band, Led Zeppelin. Many English guitar heroes followed, each with a distinctive and influential sound and attitude. Deep Purple's Ritchie Blackmore redefined guitar pyrotechnics. And in Birmingham, England, Tony Iommi energized Black Sabbath with his monster power chord. And today, every new guitar player may be influenced by Mr. Edward Van Halen.
He's changed the guitar just like Hendrix did a long time ago, but he's taken it a lot further.
He's created a style that a lot of people are influenced by. I'm inspired by it myself. But now, I feel I have my own style.
It's that style that's made Steve Vai one of today's guitar heroes. The wild-eyed boy from Long Island plays alongside Eddie's former singer, David Lee Roth. Other modern-day heavy metal guitar heroes include George Lynch, Don Dokken's six-string nemesis, Jakey Lee, the man who helped Ozzy become an ultimate sinner, Vivian Campbell, the Irishman who motorized Dio, and one of today's most critically acclaimed axemen, Sweden's Yngwie J. Malmsteen. Guitar heroes make their reputation live on stage, and no one knows this better than Steve Vai.
I don't think about anybody when I'm playing with Dave on stage. I don't think about what anybody else is thinking either. My head goes out, and I'm having a great time. I feel ecstatic on that stage. Sometimes I feel like I'm going to explode.
We would call out a hit record band. You know, we never aimed for the big smash. It was a bonus to us if it was successful.
This year, the Masters of Metal met the Master of Horror when AC/DC recorded their very first film soundtrack. Old and new AC/DC cuts made up the score to Maximum Overdrive, a film that was written and directed by writer Stephen King.
We made you! We made you! Oh, we made you!
We were lucky because Stephen King, you know, he more or less let us do what we wanted to do.
They're a headbanger group because they really, really are loud, and we're dealing with a kind of overpowering, grinding, mechanistic feel.
When he first came to us, we told him that, you know, don't look for nothing nice. if you want it nice and loud, you know, and nasty, you've come to the right place, you know. On a general scale, we've always strayed away from the Hollywood thing.
Yeah, Phil Collins seems to have covered that market quite well. Yeah.
Sorry, Phil. We don't like to think of ourselves as the same as the next band or the next guy. We've never copied anyone. To us, we're as an individual as, you know, your Rolling Stones or your Beatles or whatever.
As long as you have kids, you'll have heavy metal. I would say suburban more than urban.
It has every album that the bands you like puts out.
If, you know, something looks interesting, I buy it, yeah.
It could be today's rebellion, today's James Dean.
And how the society, you know, looks at it is wrong. I said they don't know what it's all about.
Heavy metal, though, is a pure outpouring of emotion. Good, bad, love, hate, whatever. That's its appeal. It's a very fundamental, strong, powerful sound.
It's fast. It's powerful, it's distorted, it's obnoxious metal. That's all I listen to.
It's loud, it's different, it irritates parents.
What do you want to do with your life?
In some ways, heavy metal fans are outcasts. They don't fit in with the sports kids, they don't fit in with the social kids.
They won't give me a job because of my long hair. That's their problem.
You should have short hair because you can get a better job. You, man.
It's a medium that is hated by those who misunderstand it.
People used to say that I was evil because I listened to this music.
We don't try to belong. We are it. It seems like all these like short-haired people seem to put like a label on us. It's really too bad.
Heavy metal's a way of life. It's not something you do on a weekend. It's not something you do because your friends are doing it. You wake up in the morning, you want to hear your heavy metal. You want to have a certain look.
Denim and leather, you know, it's metal. It's good because, you know, then people see you, it's a style, they know what you like.
Despite the way they dress, they're usually the very nice guys, mostly the guys. They're basically high school students who rebel by listening to the music and dressing weird.
Well, it's an identification. The kids, you know, you walk down the street wearing the t-shirt, you know, announcing to the world who, you know, you're a fan of.